or not? Are you okay with the mic check?
Johnny Walker. That's who AC spots here. If anyone wants to plug in a space heater, by all means.
There's AC.
Yeah. Well, it's mine, but still, if anybody wants to plug in a space heater.
I'm gonna go inside, but you have to. What did you say, sorry? If I go inside. No, this door is fine.
accompanied by the Chief of the Toronto Police Service, Chief William Blair. John Zivcic, who will be carried in by members of the Toronto Police Service Chief's Ceremonial Unit.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the entrance of the family, followed by Police Constable John Zivcic, who will be carried in by members of the Toronto Police Service Chief Ceremonial Unit. Please continue to stand and replace headdress as Police Constable Melissa Alastruck sings the Canadian National Anthem.
Canada, our home and native land, true patriot love in all our sons commend. With glowing hearts we see thee rise, the true North, strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free.
Please be seated and feel free to remove headdress. Good morning. John's mother, Vicky, brother Tom and his wife, Mira, sister Angie and her husband, Dr. Chris Martin, and all of John's extended family, honored guests, including politicians from all levels of government, chiefs of police, fire, and EMS chiefs, brothers and sisters in law enforcement, both sworn and civilian, citizens. On behalf of the family, I welcome you to this ceremony to mourn the loss and to celebrate the life of Police Constable John Zivcic of the Toronto Police Service, a hero in life, not death. My name is James Raymer, and I am a staff superintendent with the Toronto Police Service, and it is indeed my great honour to be here to assist with the process of this ceremony. As a former unit commander of 22 Division, I had the privilege to serve with John. John was a terrific, hardworking police officer. He always had a smile on his face and had such an engaging sense of humor. He loved his family and he loved his job. He had a sincere and genuine commitment to his profession and to his community. My thanks to Vicky and the entire Zivcic family for this honor. It is now my pleasure to introduce to you Monsignor Vladimir Zivcic. Monsignor Zivcic is John's uncle and is the pastor at St. Julia's Roman Catholic Church and St. Catherine's. He is assisted today by the Most Reverend Gerard Bergy, Bishop of the Diocese of St. Catherine's. We welcome them to this memorial and thank them for their unwavering support of the Zivcic family. Ave Maria is a classical fixture at solemn occasions. We will now hear Police Constable Melissa Olaszczyk perform the verse accompanied by longtime Zivcic family friend Cynthia Konopka on the violin, Ms. Jeannie Wise on piano, and Matej Segedi on the flute. That was absolutely fabulous. Thank you. Our first speaker is the Honourable David C. Onley, Lieutenant Governor of Ontario.
Family, friends, and colleagues have known for years. John was a devoted son, brother, and brother-in-law. He loved being with his family, and he will live on in your hearts for all time. And in some measurable way, he will live on in the minds of us all as a member of the Toronto Police Service. In short, John was dedicated to the service and protection of the people of Toronto. From a very early age, John wanted to be a police officer. Neighbors and teachers in St. Catharines remember him as a kid who always wanted to help others. His friends and colleagues at 22 Division remember him as a good cop, larger than life, and greatly respected by those who worked with him. John loved police work. He knew the risks and rewards associated with his job, and he accepted the sacrifices that are demanded of those who have given their lives to service. His death in the line of duty affects us all deeply. We mourn the loss of a young life, and we grieve the lost promise of a bright future. As the 26th Toronto police officer to die in the line of duty since the Metro Police were formed in 1957, he has joined the roll call of those who are remembered as heroes in life, not death. At the same time, we celebrate his memory in admiration of the qualities he lived by. In life and in death, John exemplified two virtues that I have always admired greatly. I suspect we all admire duty and courage. The men and women of our police services have sworn an oath to protect us and to keep our communities safe, even at the cost of their own lives. That is duty. When they go out on patrol, or to answer a call, as John did, they don't do so in the knowledge that they may be heading into dangerous, even deadly situations. And that is courage. His commitment to duty enabled John to fulfill his oath as a police officer with courage in life and in death. Even so, our words seem inadequate in the face of the inexplicable. As such, may the words of the psalmist sustain us, reminding us that we do not walk into but through the valley of the shadow of death, and that in that day I cried out, you answered me, and made me bold and strengthened my soul. As we celebrate John Zivcic's life today, may that promise be fulfilled in the lives of all who grieve his loss. Let us also pay tribute to the duty and courage of all who serve as police officers and of the families who love and support them. In the name of the Queen and on behalf of the people of Ontario, I extend our deepest condolences and sympathies for your loss. Rest in peace, John. May God keep you safe in his hand.
Camaraderie makes us think of goodwill and friendship, but it's also defined by a spirit of mutual trust. Across Ontario, in every city and throughout each community, it is this trust that we see embodied in John and all our policemen and women. There is truly no greater calling than to serve your fellow man and woman. And I know that John did so proudly and selflessly. Like his fellow frontline responders, John felt compelled to help others, to stand his ground on the line between right and wrong, to serve and protect. He was the kind of person who went out of his way to help people, not just in the line of duty, but in all parts of his life. As a man, as a police officer, John was looking for ways to contribute. He did so as a son, a brother, brother-in-law. He was there for his family, his community, and his province. And today, on behalf of all of the people of Ontario, I thank Constable John Zivcic for his contributions, for his service and sacrifice, and for protecting the trust between the people of our proud province. Our hearts are with him and his family and friends, and with the men and women of our police services across Ontario. Thank you. Merci.
Thank you, Premier Wynn. Cynthia Konopka has known the Zivcic family for years, attending Dennis Morris High School with Tom and John. The kids of the Konopka and Zivcic families have kept in touch over the years, and Cynthia eagerly agreed to sing for us today.
Say love, it is a river that drowns the tender reed. Some say love, it is a razor that leaves the soul to bleed. Some say I say love, it is a flower, and you, it's only seed. It's the one who won't be taken, who cannot seem to give, and the soul afraid of dying and never learns to live.
When the night has been too lonely and then the road has been too long and you think that love
snows lies the sea that witnessed the sun's love in the spring becomes the
thank you.
The death of a police officer while performing his lawful duties touches us all. Without question, there can be no more difficult, more onerous a responsibility for a chief of police than the guidance and leadership that must be demonstrated to the family, to the members of the service, and to the community when a member is killed in a line of duty. Our chief has fulfilled his responsibilities with distinction. It is with a great sense of pride that I introduce Chief of Police William Blair.
Thank you, Jim. Lieutenant Governor Onley, Premier Wynne, thank you for being here. We are honored by your presence and by your words. Members of John Zivcic's family, Vicky, Tom, Angie, and his extended family, we are very honored to be here with you today. Members of the Toronto Police Service from John's Platoon and 22 Division, from police divisions and units across the city, from our colleagues in policing across the province of Ontario, throughout Canada, and across North America, honored and distinguished guests, citizens of the City of Toronto that John swore an oath to serve and protect, thank you for being here with us today. You honor us, and you honor the memory of our fallen comrade by your presence here with us today. Services from across the country gathered together, and we place to the honor of the memory of Police Constable John, a valued member of the Toronto Police Service, who lost his life in a tragic motor vehicle accident while responding to a call for service. Every day, members of the Toronto Police Service and members of police services across the province of Ontario and throughout the country answer the call to duty. They have chosen to serve and protect the public. They do it with a shared sense of pride and of purpose, and they do it with the full knowledge of the risks inherent. Very well suited. John certainly looked the part of service to others, of those who were injured, but he went above and beyond. He actually reached into his own pocket to pay for medical bills, and in these actions, he demonstrated something special, a remarkable depth of character and a kind heart. And as I sat around that kitchen table with the Zivcic family, I could see where he got it. I could see where the values of that young man came from and of the family that he learned them from. And you should, and I know you are very proud of the son that you raised, a remarkable young man, a man we could all be proud to call a friend and a colleague, and a man who quite deservedly made his mother and family and the Toronto Police Service exceedingly proud. On Saturday, November the 30th, John was gravely injured while responding to a call for service. And as he was rushed to the trauma center at St. Michael's Hospital, word quickly spread across the city that one of ours had been seriously injured. Officers were anxiously at their posts to pray and wait for word on John's condition. They were soon joined by John's family, his mother Vicky, his sister Angie, his brother Tom. And over the next 2 days, his family, friends and colleagues waited anxiously and hopefully for John's condition to improve. I'd like to take this opportunity to acknowledge and thank the extraordinary people at St. Mike's for the excellent care and the great compassion that they showed to John and his family and to our extended police family as they struggled to save John's life. I also want to take the opportunity to acknowledge and thank McCormick for their leadership and for their excellent support that they provided to John's family and to all of the officers who attended at St. Mike's. Tragically, our prayers could not be answered, and John succumbed to his injuries on Monday, December the 2nd. His passing has left us with a profound sense of loss and sadness, and yet his service and dedication can inspire us with a sense of pride that he was one of ours, a member of our service. And as we march today to honor him, and as we gather to remember his service and his sacrifice, we can acknowledge that he truly was a hero in life, and like all of our heroes, he will be remembered. On behalf of the Toronto Police Service, I'd like to express my most heartfelt and sincere condolences to John's mother, Vicky, his brother, Tom, and sister, Angie, to his grandmother, to his family, and to his friends. that is strength of character, passion, were all virtues taught to him in a loving home. If any further evidence of that this generosity was a virtue of his home, we can only be inspired by the Zivcic family's decision to donate John's great heart and other organs to the Trillium organization so that others could. John's passing has meant new hope for several families and saved several lives. And I would hope that we would all be inspired by the Zivcic family's example and that we would follow their example. I would also like to thank and acknowledge all who have joined with us today, those who have come by 22 Division, those who have come by headquarters, those who have sent messages of condolences and support, the support of our colleagues in public safety from across the country and from the citizens that we are sworn to serve and protect is very meaningful and appreciated by all of us. Thank you for being here today. Constable Zivcic, rest in peace. We will remember you. God bless you all and keep you safe.
Thank you, Chief. Commander is called upon to manage the overall business of the division, from the inner workings of the police station to the immensely rewarding. The unity of the tragedy in a way that spurs the members to continue to serve the community. 22 Division has such a leader, and I am honored to introduce to you Superintendent Frank Bergen.
Lose 4 hours. Name tag almost fell off. I'm okay. I apologize for that. Chief Blair, Mrs. Zivcic, Tom, Mira, Angie, Chris, and Lila, Staff Sergeant behalf of 20, to cope with many realities, many tough, some effortlessly, and a few that became impossible. One constant has been the brotherhood and loyalty of our service, our community, and the determination to honour our pledge to serve and protect. Although we at 22 Division may say the world revolves around only south Etobicoke, we have been certainly reminded there is an amazing support mechanism at every corner of this Toronto and beyond. We've only been able to maintain station continuity because we have received so much support from each and every one of you. Thank you. Thank you for the pizza and donuts. Thanks for the call and cards. And thanks for the members who have walked through our door, picked up a set of keys, a radio, and a scout car. Constable John Zivcic reported for duty on Saturday, November the 30th. And John, time in the near future. We must all make the best of the time that we have been given, from first learning of the news on Saturday to this event and on to the Thursday afternoon mass. We must use this time wisely to cry, to reflect, to laugh. All of us at 22 are struggling to cope with this reality, and we've had to lean on our brotherhood to understand. And let's face it, we needed this extra time so as the Go Review team can push the occurrence through to our stalled printers across the city. Since learning of this accident and attending St. Michael's Hospital to join a growing legion of friends gathering to offer support and ultimately lay vigil, I have had the opportunity to really get to know John. John the cop, John the friend, John the Good Samaritan, and most certainly John the amazing son to Vicky, brother to Tom and Angie, and uncle to Lila. at work, he treated the public with respect. He was a natural, open, honest, and funny. Whenever he started a shift, he would always shake your hand with an accompanying good morning, good afternoon, or good night. He was just so humble, polite, and courteous. John was hardworking, friendly, and very professional. And I were at John's condo about a month ago, helping him prep his apartment for sale. Her husband is the real estate agent. It was a total bachelor pad, a lot of mood lighting, silk, and red shag. It took a lot of work. Cleanse the closet. Well, without getting too specific, apparently there were a few, and by that I mean a lot, of souvenirs. Now, to be clear, John didn't want them, and he actually offered them to Jamie. She told him that in no uncertain term that she did not want any of it, instead donated the lot. Sergeant Ray Dorenzo, Constable Kim Lister McLeod, offered that they had served their 6-month training in traffic at the same time. At one point in the office, several of the traffic cars were out of commission. He looked for a car, but there were no free scout cars to take. So John came back beaming because he had found the keys to the safety bug. So he went, it was a 2-door Volkswagen that was usually reserved for the elementary bag to go out on the road. You're not really going out in that. 6'5" police. He would then go onto YouTube and play Croatian accordion folk music at full volume to get himself psyched up to do his reports. He would then start to sing along to the music and pretend to play the air accordion. Apparently, in his younger days, entertain us or make us laugh. That was John. On a serious note, when we recently returned traffic to PRU, staff dueling chose to keep John as a permanent enforcement car. This made John's day, and he performed at 150%. It should also be noted that no one didn't have his shirt on. Very intimidating. He pointed to Paul's tux and said, "Up there." The day Paul got hired, he received the call to pick up his uniform. And immediately upon getting home, Paul, as we all did, put it on and drove down the street to show Angie. Now, just to be clear, Chris, we didn't all go down to show Angie our uniform, but just wanted to make sure. John answered the door, again, no shirt on. And he looked Paul up and down and said, "That's no big deal," and turned and walked away. Paul waited for Angie and excitedly talked about his pending division, shift, and start time. John continued to stare down Paul and finally said, "What's that, a vest?" Paul said, "Yes, sir, it's my bulletproof vest." Moped accident in front of him. The author of the letter says that John approached the scene of the accident and without a second thought, took complete control. The author went on to say that she was terribly injured and unable to move. The off-duty officer tied the lady's legs, ripped off his shirt, and applied a pressure bandage tourniquet to stop the bleeding. John hailed a cab and carried the lady to the cab, rode to the hospital, and then carried her into the hospital and put her in a stretcher. John stayed with the lady for more than 3 hours while she received medical attention. Not only did John stay with the lady, he also paid her medical bill, as she had no wallet or means of payment with her at the time. John returned later that evening to check on her. She wrote, "I do not know what I would have done without the selfless acts of John, and he's coming to my aid," where he represented the Toronto Police Department with incredible kindness and professionalism. John received a commendation from the Chief of Police in December 2009 for his actions. When division, saying thank you just doesn't seem to be enough. On Tuesday afternoon, the Zivcic family came to our station to get a better understanding of John's routine. We took them through the building, stood at John's desk in the Barney Miller-esque traffic office and ended up in the makeshift lobby of our building, which is under construction. They were shown the growing number of flowers, the cards and the signatures in the books of condolences, and our appreciative public. The Zivcic family's interest in our lives has truly been a blessing. 22 Division has recently decommissioned our firing range, and as such, we have a great room with much potential in the basement. In fact, we used it to have a very difficult debrief on Sunday evening with B-Platoon. The EMS officers and the communication team that greatly managed the scene, transport, and eventual arrival at St. Mike's. We are forever grateful for the chaos oversight demonstrated by dispatcher Emily Mark Corneal and the initial rush to the side of Constable Zivcic by off-duty ETF Sergeant Terry Zadora and his 15-year-old son, Alec. Thank you to St. Mike's Hospital Emergency and the 9th floor ICU. Thank you also to Constables Steve Kirpus and Julio Bevilacqua, who have since Saturday evening been completely dedicated to the Zivcic family as police liaison. In closing, I have two final thoughts. Vicky, Tom, and Mira, Chris and Lila, and Angie. It from the lens of two very different worlds. John was an amazing son, brother, man, a special friend, and a great cop. For me, there were two concepts: your obvious connection to physical fitness and your shared workouts with your brother is the best way for our members to connect with him. Secondly, there was the call Chris received in the middle of planning the funeral. Not a great time for sure. Chris, you took the call, and upon close, with tears in your eyes, you announced the kidney and liver are spoken for, and the heart is going to a recipient in Boston. We all broke down, and we soon returned to reality in sheer joy when it came to the realization that that recipient was getting the biggest, strongest, B Platoon. We can live in the past, we should dream of the future, however, it must always be the best that we can be in the present. I can already see that each one of you is standing a little taller as you try to emulate the stature of our patrol partner, John. I was so moved and proud to learn that upon notification on Monday, December the 2nd, of the worst possible news, that collectively you assembled, dressed in uniform, and marched on our station flagpole. Quietly and with every due dignity and respect, you lowered our station flag to half-mast. Staff Sergeant Glenn Dooling, I have one last request. We had a trying week, and again we'll pay spiritual respect to John on Thursday at the community mass. Staff, 22 Division B Platoon will be reporting for duty on December 13th for night shift, working the 14th. Glenn, once your platoon is on the road,
thank you, Frank. Please take a moment now to reflect on the life. Photographs is displayed on the screens.
Thank you. Thank you.
thanks to the Toronto Police Pipe Band. They always do a outstanding job, particularly with that time-honored song. Our next and final speaker is Tom Zivcic, John's brother.
They say that a man's greatest honor is to speak about a man that is even greater. They say to be chosen to speak and celebrate a man's life is the greatest tribute one can ever give. I was married 2 months ago and had that great man speak at my wedding. He was my best man. I remember looking at him and thinking, God, I hope he doesn't screw this up. But he delivered the most heartfelt, sincere, genuine, funny speech I believe anyone has ever heard. I knew how difficult it would be for him to stand up in front of 500 make me proud, and I was. I've never been any proud. Fortunately, I won't have the opportunity to reciprocate that feeling back to him and speak at his wedding. So I guess this has to be my best man speech to him. If my dad to drive help him throw all around the neighborhood. They would then come back, sit in the garage and have a drink, talk and relax. We were sitting around the table the other night reminiscing about that story, and someone made a good point about it. Imagine in today's age telling someone that the garbage man took your 7-year-old child. And that your boy spends his Thursday mornings drinking his juice box in the garage while the garbage man is having a beer, drinking on the job at 10:30 in the morning. We call those the good old days. When we were kids, we'd spend every second of every day together. That's how close we were. His laughter was infectious and crippling. When you would hear it, you couldn't help but laugh with him. It would fill a dark room with blinding light. His face, that smile, those eyes, you could read it like a book. You knew exactly what he was thinking, what he was feeling, and what he was about to do. John was a star athlete in everything he played, excelling in soccer and tennis, basketball, and finally his most favorite hobby of all, working out. He was 2 years younger than me, but played with all my friends and on all my sports teams. This cultivated him to be better than most in his age group, but more importantly, it fueled competition, a burning desire for him to be just as good as his older brother. We spent our time playing outside, playing Nintendo and pretending to be WWF wrestlers. In those days, my mom found herself running to consumers distributing, constantly buying and replacing the remote controls my brother would break every time he would lose a Nintendo game. He couldn't stand losing and refused to be beaten. One winter day, we were building a fort in the snow and we started wrestling WWF style. I was able to drop a flying elbow on him and hold him down for a 3 count. I stood up and said, "That's right, I'm the champ. Got the title." I walked away, leaving him there crying and angry. There was a pile of snow at the base of my grandmother's window, as well as a basket of clothespins. I'm not exactly sure why I was there, but I recall standing under one of those old school clotheslines that extended to the neighbor's yard, and from it was hanging a yellow boat rope. In the meantime, I think John turned green and became the Incredible Hulk. Not accepting to be beaten, he couldn't contain himself. He ran over to me, grabbed me from the back, wrapped the yellow rope around my neck, and kicked my legs out from underneath me. I fell down, and so did the clothesline, breaking my collarbone. I saw John run away, thinking that my dearest brother was going to go get help. To my dismay, he was too busy screaming, "The champ is down! The champ is down!" and that he was the new and undisputed World Wrestling Federation champion of the world. And yes, to this day, he's still a champ. My dad came home and was mad that we were fighting yet again and that we broke the clothesline. "What's the matter with you? You're supposed to be the oldest," he said to me. So he did what he knew best as a loving old school European dad. He beat me for John breaking my collarbone. John was a special child, far from ordinary. He was an incredible talent at all that he did. He was imaginative, creative, and hardworking. Although he finished in top of his police college class, in elementary school he came home with all D's. During report card time, with a straight face, he somehow convinced my parents that for whatever reason, he didn't receive his report card that term, and that his teacher still must have it. 3 weeks later, our neighbor and good family friend came over with an envelope. He explained to my parents that he found an envelope jammed into his wood pile on the side of the house and that it had been addressed to John. My parents opened it, and to their disbelief, it was John's report card. You see, even at a young age, he already had the intuition to avoid danger, especially when pertaining to our parents. John had incredible passion. He was intense with everything he did. He had a contagious smile and sparkle in his eyes. There was an energy about him that even he could barely contain. He lived his life based on principle. Right was right, and wrong was wrong. John was the essence of compassion, duty, and style. He was a simple man with simple, hard values instilled by our Croatian culture, and by two loving parents that shaped and molded him into the man he became. He was a role model, and he set the standard what every son should be to his family. I was asked in an interview a few days ago, what do I think drove John to be a police officer? Two things came to mind. The first one was presence. John and I went to eat something after bar one night at one of those breakfast places, and in walked two ETF police officers. The one guy in particular was about 6'8", had to have been about 300 pounds all muscle. The look on John's face was priceless. He was in such awe of that officer that he had food falling out of his mouth. Now that alone told a story that will one day be his legacy. John wanted to be that guy. He wanted to be ETF. He wanted people to stand there and also and have food fall out of their mouths when he walked into a room. The irony here is it was actually an off-duty ETF officer who was the first on scene to help Johnny. Thank you to that man. So the second thing that drove John to be a police officer was that he wasn't afraid to stand up for what is right. After going to the gym together and maintaining our pump, John wanted to go to the mall to eat at the food court. He loved the mall, especially Sherway, and all that it had to offer. As we were sitting there eating, Three teenagers, maybe 13, 14, two boys, one girl, were sitting there throwing cups of ketchup. The floor and the tables in front of them were completely covered in red while they were laughing like immature morons and disrupting everybody around them. An older lady, Filipino, must have been the janitor on duty at that time. She went over and kneeled down and started wiping and cleaning up the mess. Well, then it just got worse. They took another cap and threw it to the left, saying, "Hey lady, you missed a spot." Keeping her head down, she crawled over and started cleaning up the mess. Then they threw another one in the opposite direction. Again, "Hey lady, you missed a spot," and laughing uncontrollably. Everyone in the food court looked on in disgust. This could have been a scene from that show, What Would You Do? Then in a split second, John flew out of his seat, throwing every single seat and chair and table out of his way to get to that poor Filipino lady. He was so scary that the kids were frozen watching him come at them. I was scared watching him leave. He pulled all three kids out of their seat at once and dragged them to the counter to get napkins, then dragged them back screaming at them. He picked the Filipino lady up off the floor by her arm and kept them wiping and cleaning the mess they made till it was spotless. When they were done, he told them that if he ever saw or heard of them doing this to anyone again, he would find them and, well, I'm sure you can imagine the words that came out of his mouth. As they ran out of the food court crying, the crowd stood up to give John a standing ovation. You see, to that lady that day, John was one in a million. He had zero tolerance for bullying and abuse. John was the type of man men wanted to be. He had presence, he had integrity, he had character. Man, did he have character. He was authentic. What you see is what you got. Very simple. He's a guy that women loved and wanted to be around. He had tenderness, respect, loyalty, courage. That's what makes him a terrific brother, son, and uncle. He had qualities that are only written about. But to have seen John as a father, that is where he really would have shined. He spent all of his days off with his niece, Lila. She was the love of his life. He demanded daily pictures from her, from my sister, so he could share them with everyone he met. He would drive an hour to see her, be with her for only an hour, and then drive another hour home. He would fit her in whenever he could. Why? Because that's what a real man does. He makes time when there is none. He is the guy that takes her for ice cream and comes home with four new outfits for his little princess. He is the guy that goes to Whole Foods and buys organic filet mignon just to have my sister mush it up into baby food. Why? Because nothing was good enough for his little Lila. You see, he wasn't trying to teach her to be a lady. He was showing her how one was to be treated. My only regret is that Lila's future boyfriends wouldn't have the chance to meet him. But I'm sure her mom, and especially her dad, can tell her all about him. John was a big guy with a big heart. He performed acts of kindness that were very special. They were even more amazing because he didn't tell anybody about them. My sister received a message on her phone from someone we didn't know when we were in the hospital. The message that was left to my sister the other night was this: "You don't know who I am. I am sorry for calling like this, but I knew your brother quite well. Sorry for your loss. I met John a few years ago and was involved in a serious domestic abuse situation. John came to the call. He was really nice and nice enough to leave his card and said for me to call him if I needed anything. So I did many of times, as I had nobody else to talk to. He made time to talk to me or to see me always. I had two small children and I'm raising them alone. The last time I spoke to John was because my dog had died. My children were crushed and it was even worse because I couldn't afford to buy them another. I proceeded to tell John all about it, and according to the new rules of the condo, we were not allowed to have any new animals once existing ones died. But 1 week later, John showed up at my place with a puppy in his arms. It was the exact dog that my kids wanted. I can't believe he did that for my kids and for my family. Again, I'm so sorry for what had happened. He didn't deserve that. I just wanted to share this story with you. Bye. John had a big heart, both figuratively and literally. When John was in the hospital, we were discussing organ donation with the Trillium team. Donating John's heart was the easy part. Finding a recipient was not. First, the heart needed to be given to someone that was large enough for it. It couldn't be put into a smaller body. John would have loved knowing that fact. I'm just too big. I'm sorry. I'd give you my heart, but I'll tell you what, go put on a couple pounds and come back in 2 years and I'll give it to you then. Secondly, John has a rare blood type that only 5% of the population has. The lady with the Trillium Foundation had said that finding a recipient would be difficult because all those criteria would need to be met. It would be an incredible gift, but because the probability of finding someone is next to impossible, because finding someone is next to impossible. We prayed together as a family and hoped that someone would be a candidate. We needed some good to come out of this tragedy. Thankfully, a recipient was found, and John's heart was successfully accepted. His kidneys stayed in Toronto and were given to two recipients. John made Christmas for three families, and to them, I'm sure they also felt he was one in a million, a hero and a savior. It is comforting to our family that somewhere out there, John's heart will continue to beat. John was truly an angel sent from God. He was given a gift, and that gift was shared with all that knew him. He tried to bring happiness to all of our lives. He gave strength to our family and was the rock that always kept us together. We would like to thank the entire Toronto Police Service, the Police Association, emergency first responders, St. Mike's Hospital, friends and family, citizens of the GTA, and all the officers and public officials who have come here today. We appreciate your support in helping us get through this difficult time. We would especially like to thank the men and women of 22 Division where John worked. They are nothing short of amazing. It was incredible to have the support of John's second family, particularly the members of his platoon. We had a chance the other night to visit John's division and saw the desk he sat at, his locker, and the halls he walked every day. Listening to all your stories about John has made this horrible experience a lot easier for us, and I hope that in John's place, I can continue those great friendships that he has forged with all of you. We would like to thank all of you for coming and taking the time to remember John. I would just like to take one more moment and read to you something that was shared to me on Facebook. It's a question. Hey, police officer, I pay your salary. What do you make? That question, I'm sure, sounds familiar to all of you. The response? I make holding your hand seem like it's the most important thing in the world when someone tried to hurt you. I make those annoying sirens seem like angels when you need them. Breathe when he stops. I make myself get out of bed. I make myself go to work for your family's safety, a duty that I will die for. I make myself work birthdays, holidays, nights, anniversaries, and disasters. Today, I might make the ultimate sacrifice to save your life. I make a difference. What do you make? Thank you, all of you, that make that difference, just as my brother John did. We give thanks for the life of a man I'm so proud to call my brother. The unique, the intense, the sensitive, the extraordinary and irreplaceable John, whose beauty, internal and external, will never be extinguished from our minds and hearts. Johnny, tell God to get you a pair of 200-pound dumbbells. I'll be there to spot you when we see each other again. Love you, Brizzo.
Thank you, Tom. That was very moving, and we all understand how difficult it was for you to do. Monsignor Vladimir Zivcic will now lead us in scripture, followed by Cynthia Konopka performing Panis Angelicus.
Thank you, Tommy, once again for sharing a beautiful story about John. With your friends and family, let us raise our voices now in prayer and ask our merciful and loving God to hear us in our moment of need and in our moment of praise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We believe that all the ties of friendship and affection which knit us as one throughout our lives do not unravel with death. Confident that God always remembers the good we have done, and it is kind and generous in forgiving our sins, we pray, asking God to gather John unto himself. Lord, in our grief, we turn to you. Are you not the God of love who opened your ears to all? Listen to our prayers for your son, John, this world. Lead him to your kingdom and light and peace, and count him among the saints in glory. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Dr. Martin.
A reading from the Book of Lamentations. My soul is shut out from peace. I have forgotten happiness. And now I say, my strength is gone, that hope which came from the Lord. Brooding on my anguish and affliction is gall and wormwood. My spirit ponders it continually and sinks within me. This is what I shall tell my heart and so recover hope. The favors of the Lord are not all past. His kindness are not exhausted. Every morning they are renewed. Great is his faithfulness. My portion is the Lord, says my soul, and so I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who trust him. To the soul who searches for him, it is good to wait in silence for the Lord to save. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still, and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. If there were not, I should have told you. And after I have gone and prepared your place, I shall return to take you with me, so that where I am, you may be too. You know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus said, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. With your friends, we as a family have chosen these beautiful readings from the Book of Lamentations and the Gospel of John. The Book of Lamentations speaks of grief, loss, and the darkness that Israelites felt being away from home, being taken away, and longing for their home. It was the experience in the face of great experienced in great loss, and it gives us three options to deal with this grief. Our choice is to ignore death, to minimize death, or to embrace it. By embracing it, we also embrace trust and hope. Out of trust and hope, love is born. Painful as it may be, this life, this love is life-giving and brings peace to the mournful soul. This truly speaks to our experience this week. It has been a difficult week. So many ups and downs, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. We wished we could have ignored it. We wished we could have minimized it. But truly, we are only left with embracing this loss because of the faith and hope we have in our merciful and loving God. In the Gospel from St. John, we heard the words, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still, and trust in me. I go to prepare a place for you." Jesus's departure from this world was imminent when he spoke these words, and this was a source of great anxiety for the believers and followers. While he was still with them, his presence centered and strengthened them. But the thought of his absence filled them with dread and grief. He assured them and assures us that we are never alone, that he will be with us on the journey that lies ahead. And ultimately, he makes it known to us that we will be with him in heaven forever because of the great love he has for each one of us. In these times of tragedy, we may experience even despair. Where is God in all this, people ask? I can assure you that God has been with us this week. We have felt his presence always in the comments and gestures of what we do for you. Parents who have come last night, wonderful story of bearing their children, young, prosperous, looking at life. There were parents of police officers who came to offer support and proudly announced, "We are parents of a police officer." And we find great comfort in knowing that John's gift of life continues to donation of his organs, giving hope to those struggling with sickness. In our Catholic tradition, we end our funeral service with these words: may every mark of affection and every gesture of friendship that you give to others be a sign of God's presence and God's peace for you. And our prayer continues that the Lord will multiply our faith, that he will strengthen our hope, and that he will perfect our love. We pray that John will be welcome to the place prepared for us, and we pray for each of us here that we may see comfort together and respond, "Lord, hear our prayer." In baptism, John received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer unjustly these sins against your love, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For those who serve and protect, for those who see, heal, and care, especially those who served with John and cared for him in his last days, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the health and strength of those who have received John's organs, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. The family and friends of John seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. We pray to the Lord. With longing for our heavenly homeland, let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May John rest in peace. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace.
At this time, members of the Chief's Ceremonial Unit will assist Chief Blair as he presents Police Constable
words to her.
Most Reverend Gerard Burgee, Bishop of the Diocese of St. Catharines, will conduct the blessing.
Into your hands, Father of Mercies, we commend our brother John, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the many blessings which you have bestowed upon John in this life. They are signs to all of us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Father, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our dear brother John forever and ever. And may the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
At this time, the body of Police Constable John Zivcic will be carried from the room by members of the Chief Ceremonial Unit, followed by the Lieutenant Governor and the Premier. The following people will form a guard of honor outside: the chief in command officers, the members of 22 Division, including the first responders involved in this critical incident. I would ask everyone else to stand and remain here while the procession leaves the room and the honor guard forms up outside. Please watch the monitors.
Cut!